Are you listening?
Good.
Let me share something with you. Weight loss strategies. We've all heard them. Caloric reduction. If it fits your macros. Low-fat diets. And of course, low-carb, high-fat, ketogenic diets. Everywhere you go, there's crazy critics being thrown around. But even crazier, people that actually hold on to them.
Long term, it's hard. People miss some fruits, different vegetables, grains. It's hard, it becomes a very restrictive diet.
Diets designed to take inches off the waistline could potentially end up taking years off someone's life. Cutting down on carbohydrates and foods like pasta and bread may reduce life expectancy by up to 4 years.
Keto will look as though it works, but in terms of performance, no. In terms of heart health, no. In terms of kidney health, no. In terms of overall health and well-being, no. If you're not eating carbohydrate, I mean, you're going against your body's physiology.
It throws your body into a state of emergency. That's what ketosis is.
However, this is not one of those critics.
What would you do? Imagine this. You're suddenly told to give up the habits, the values, and the lifestyle choices that you have made that have gotten you to feel good about yourself. And all you're left with are 20 days and a bit of hope. What would you do from day number 1 to day number 20 to fix the issue? That's an interesting question, isn't it? It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life, ladies and gentlemen. And that is how you finish it off. Day number 1.
New Jersey did it.
And so begins a 20-day experiment to gain weight and become unhealthy and losing the weight back with the ketogenic diet. This is gonna be my lunch today. I really don't know if I actually should eat it. That is, look how sticky that is. today I'm gonna be making myself some tortilla wraps because I haven't eaten any of those in ages. I'm gonna be making myself some wraps with some rice, tortillas, and some ground beef to that. So let's see how that goes.
Alright, so here we go. This one. So rice and tortilla wraps in the pocket. Now it's all about the cooking. Let's go.
Alright, so here's the thing, right? It's day number two of the experiment and I noticed two things. The one thing is, every time I move, my entire body is like fatigued the entire time. I usually walk a lot, I usually move a lot during the day. I'm a very active person, but since I woke up today, I haven't been really able to move a lot simply because my legs are kind of tired. My arms, I just don't feel as strong as I usually do. Now the second thing is that last night I had to wake up because I was sweating. I was sweating a lot and I've been sweating a lot ever since. Like, I'm very hot and this is not something that usually happens, but it's something that I've noticed as well. So it's day number two of the experiment and let's see how day number three turns out. Talking bands, I got it. Benjamin's in my pocket. I prayed in my truth for some Robin. So today we're gonna go grocery shopping. So the biggest sentence I experienced were today on day number three. First of all, I woke up with a massive headache. After that, I just have been tired the entire day. I had to take like two naps in between because I just couldn't focus on regular projects, writing. I couldn't do anything. Yeah, so right now we're gonna go grocery shopping with a friend of mine, and we will try to stick to a low budget. But honestly, all of these crappy processed carbohydrates tend to be very low ticket, so I think we might be able to get a lot for a low budget, but we're working through it right now. I got the Glock in my Robbie, 17 shots, no 38. Yeah, I got the Glock in my Robbie, 17 shots, no 38. She's fine. First up, we're gonna get some donuts, guys. Come on, come with me. Alright, so I must say, it's been probably 5 years since I've had my last donut. It's the first one, right? Come on, let's move to the next one. Sandwich bread. Let's just check the macros. I mean, let's just check the label. 45 grams of carbs. So this one is
also 25 grams. 25 grams. So, surprisingly, all cereal boxes have 25 grams of sugar. Let's keep shopping, guys. All right, so, we've got some crisps, some chips, some potato chips. Let's keep moving, come on. Time for a quick recap. Come here. So far we have some brownies. We got brownies. We have some strawberry milk right there. Marshmallows. We got some chocolate, guys. We got sandwich bread. Potato chips. Donut. Alright, I think I'm ready.
Whoa.
What, too much? So it's late at night. It's about 1 a.m. in the morning. I just woke up. My head is just killing me. Like, I don't know why. Yesterday I remember having some, you know, some joint pain, feeling weak and having this massive headache, but I'm gonna try to go to sleep again, get some rest. I'm really looking forward to phase two, but I have yet to finish phase one, so. One thing you should know is the fact that you can't out-train a bad diet. You can't out-train a bad diet. And I'm just not just telling you this for looks. I'm not just telling you this for the way you're gonna look, but the way you're gonna feel. I'm 4 days into this experiment and I can tell you this right now has been one of the toughest, if not the toughest, training session I've had in a long, long time. Whoa! So when it comes to weight loss, one thing that comes to mind is working out as hard as you can for as long as you can. And it's easy to think so, yet as you have seen and as you will continue to see along this video, despite having worked out every single day of the week, I still gain fat. And this has to do with the fact that exercise is not the definitive factor when it comes to getting rid of those extra pounds. You know, over the past few years, there have been many long-term randomized studies showing that exercise has minimal to no effect on weight loss. And to make this even clearer, let's take a look at the largest and most expensive health study ever done, the Women's Health Study. Over 39,000 women took part and were divided into three groups representing low, medium, and high levels of weekly exercise. And even though during those 10 years, they were assigned a group, women on the intense exercise group hardly lost weight or experienced any sort of body composition change. And this is not to say that you should not work out or that you should not be active whatsoever, please. But rather, that we should consider additional factors when it comes to losing weight, as you'll find out in this experiment. Number 6 of the experiment so far, and as you can probably tell by the journey you and I have been going through so far, that I'm starting to notice some body composition changes. You probably can tell that I've gained a few pounds, that I've gained a little bit of weight. One thing are the body composition changes that I've been experiencing, the weight that I've been gaining so far, but most importantly, I've been noticing some changes in the way I feel. So as I have reported back, my workouts have been a lot more challenging, and I've been having a lot of problems when it came to sustaining an energy level for the entire day. As you can probably tell, what you eat really reflects back on your performance with your family, in your job, your workout, athletic performance. So unfortunately, in phase one, I'm noticing this on a negative way, which is why I'm actually glad to say that phase number one is almost over. We have a few days remaining, and I'm curious to see what the final result is gonna look like after phase two of the experiment. But so far, these are the changes I've been going through, the way I have been feeling for myself compared to the way I usually am, and we'll see how this develops all throughout the remaining days of the week. So it's day number 7, and this is actually quite a special one, because today is my sister's birthday, and you know what this means. I mean, since we're in phase 1, it's not as tragic. However, this means that today I'm not gonna be having the availability to stick to healthy food. So today is gonna be a day full of eating out, full of maybe cake. I mean, we got a piñata right here, and so it's day number 7 of phase 1 in the experiment, and alright, so we're currently at a Mexican restaurant, and as I said, it's a special occasion, so we're about to eat like some tortilla wraps. We're probably gonna be eating some nachos. We will see how this affects my body later on today, maybe tomorrow morning. But yeah, I'll keep you updated.
Alright, so today, I'm actually going to order some burgers, alright? I've gone grocery shopping, I've cooked myself some food, I have gone out and to eat something, you know, at a restaurant as well. And now it's time to order some food. You know, we got to have the four pictures and we got to try everything out and see how that affects me while it's still being in phase one. I mean, I think you can start to see my skin is also starting to, you know, starting to notice. Maybe that's because of the oxidation.
Some brownies.
These ones?
Yeah.
They wanted me to add 100 milliliters of freaking vegetable oil right here. I ended up adding some coconut oil to this. I mean, it's processed enough, but I need to have some self-respect. I mean, usually those mixtures here are the worst. Usually those have like the worst effects. I'll see how this goes. Today is gonna be brownie day, as you can see right here. Let's see how the final day of phase one goes.
Caloric reduction is no new approach to weight loss. Yet, is it the best approach? You know, probably our biggest error is believing that weight loss follows a simple formula. Calories in minus calories out equals body fat. And with this assumption, the typical approach would be to reduce the amount of food that we eat. Yet, for whatever reason, it just doesn't work, or we just feel like crap. A study conducted in 1919 followed the goal of finding out what happens when we reduce our caloric intake. And so they put volunteers on diets 30% fewer in calories than their usual caloric intake. And what they found was that as calories in were reduced, so were calories out, so the calories that we burn. Leaving us to believe that these two variables are highly dependent of one another. And when you think about it, it kind of makes sense, right? I mean, your body has to adapt to fewer energy coming in so they can still function appropriately. Energy, for example, to keep you warm, which is why you tend to feel cold when you severely calorie restrict. Or energy to move the body, which is why you tend to feel weak when you restrict your portion sizes. And this has to do with our metabolism, right? Because your body wants to survive. It doesn't have like a sort of detector to tell if you're on a sort of weight loss protocol. And because of that, it will set you up in a way that makes it easy for you to gain weight. And however, when we stall because of this, the typical approach is to restrict even further and further until ultimately we fall off the wagon and get back to our usual routines. However, because your metabolism has slowed down, you will eventually regain the weight back. And even worse, despite having given it all your effort with nutrition and in the gym, your friends keep telling you that you're just not committed and just weak. Has that ever happened to you? Yeah, there has to be another way.
Now, I must admit, the brownies from yesterday, they did cause quite a substantial difference in me. You ever heard of disaster pants? They cost me exactly what I thought they were gonna cost, and that was that my gut just did not play the game with me. My gut just wasn't following along, and I must say this was a very, very uncomfortable afternoon. But luckily today is the final day of the of phase number one, and so yeah, I will keep you updated with that, and let's see how the final part of the experiment actually turns out to be.
Alright guys, welcome, and this is day number 10 of the experiment. It's officially the last day of phase number 1. Today we're going to look at what my body looks like at the end of phase 1, and this will serve as a comparison after the end of phase 2, which is going to be the phase where I will try to get back to where I was before I started the experiment. So I would say we jump straight into it. Let's look at what my body looks like now, and let's then take a look at how phase 2 is gonna affect my body. Something beautiful, but there is also something really hard about changing your life, about changing the way you look and the way you feel, right? Especially when it's the very, very, very first day and you have a huge journey in front of you. You know, it's day number 1 of phase number 2 in this experiment, and it is hard. It is hard, especially when you see yourself in a position that you do not want to be, and when you have to put in the work, when you have to make the sacrifices, you have to give up certain foods, and you have to give up the free time to work out and to invest in your own health. The purpose of this is to show you that it's possible, and that you can do it. That if you commit to it, you can. You just gotta devote yourself to it. It's not easy, but it's not impossible. Just feeling and seeing myself doing something for the better helps me to feel great instantaneously, because I know that I'm gonna be improving every single day. It's a marathon and it's not a sprint. Invest in other factors that influence how you feel on a day-to-day basis, because it's very, very important. And it's time to become healthy again. I just finished my workout, and it's a very great way for me to start off my day. It gets me going, it gets me ready to prepare myself for what is gonna happen today, for all the tasks that I have to carry out today. And this is a really great way to get some movement in and to really become a little bit more mindful about what is going to happen today. But today is actually a very special day. I mean, it's the second day of phase number 2, but this also means that today it's time to reshift my perspective again. And here's how we're gonna do this, okay? Okay, it's very simple, because you're gonna be doing yourself a favor by doing this the way I'm gonna share it with you right now, and it requires 2 steps. So right here with me, I have got a huge box full of all of the packages from all of the foods that I have been consuming over the past 10 days. You can see we have got everything from pizza boxes to ice cream boxes. We have here cookie packages, everything. And all of that food I have been consuming over the past 10 days. You went with me through this journey, and you actually noticed and saw how I felt, what I looked like, what I experienced, and you probably have experienced that yourself anytime in your life, because we have all been a victim to these type of temptations. And right now for me, as I want to get into phase number two and I want to get back to where I was before the experiment, there is one crucial factor that will not only benefit me but actually benefit you if you start implementing this right now. And you have to get rid of every temptation that's in your way. If your psychology and your mindset is still attached to those temptations, eventually you will give in and fall off. So you have to make your best effort to get rid of those. And what is the best way to get rid of the pizzas, to get rid of everything that's in your way that may stop you from getting to your goal, is you have to throw them in the trash can. Because otherwise you will actually be driving yourself insane if you have to constantly keep fighting and resist the temptation. And that's what I'm gonna do today. And instead, what you wanna do is you wanna replace those with whole, real foods. You wanna replace those with foods that will actually benefit your body. So that is the goal. And that is really the beauty of this lifestyle, is that you're not forcing it, but you're actually doing yourself a favor by putting yourself in a position that guarantees that you won't give in and that you won't fall off the wagon. So keep that in mind, because it's actually a very important point. And I don't see many people talking about this, but this is more important than you think, because one part is covering the nutrition, but you also have to be mindful of your mindset and the effort you have to give in to resist the temptations. So keep that in mind. Alright, so one question I get asked a lot when it comes to the ketogenic lifestyle, when it comes to intermittent fasting, is how do you start your day off in a way that it benefits your health, that it benefits weight loss, fat burning, and that you actually feel great? And this actually surprises a lot of people, but I like to start my day off in a fasted state. And what I mean by that is that I usually wait till a certain time period of the day where I consume most of my meals. And this usually incorporates me skipping breakfast or me skipping lunch even. Most people would think that, man, you're gonna lose a lot of muscle, you're gonna feel tired, you are not gonna be able to deal with anybody, and many people report feeling like sort of hangry. You know, they feel like they need to kill somebody when they didn't eat something for 3 hours or something like this. And it's totally understandable. Like, I was that myself when I first got into this. But the good thing is I had a great support system, and I made sure to contact the right people to provide me with the right knowledge and guidance so that I could actually become adapted to this. And nowadays, I even enjoy doing all of my chores in the first part of the day in a fasted state. I don't know, I feel sharper, I feel better. And the great thing about this is also I'm more productive. Many people tend to get confused because they don't know how fasting can actually be something productive in the end. But there is actually a lot of things you can do.
You can work out. You can read a book. You can go for a walk. You can go grocery shopping.
And then you're gonna break the fast. And right now I got myself some eggs with some olives, some spinach, and I'm enjoying this meal. But yeah, that's it for this day. I'm feeling great so far and making progress, and let's see how this goes. We'll be right back.
So there is a lot of controversy when it comes to the ketogenic diet, because many people assume it is very restrictive. Because at the beginning, especially at the beginning, a lot of people don't know what to eat. They don't know what to do. And simply because of the lifestyle they've been living before, and I was a victim of that myself. You know, I embarked on a ketogenic diet, and coming from a high carb background, I just didn't know what to eat or what foods to switch to. What I always recommend to people and people that I work with is try out a lot of things and experiment with new recipes, experiment with different cuisines that may actually help you with this lifestyle, or you try to look for replacements in the beginning. And so today I'm actually going to be doing a keto friendly pizza recipe, because I know a lot of people find it very hard to give up pizza, or to give up burgers, to give up cornflakes, which by the way I have a recipe for all of that. I'm gonna just check it out. Take a look at a recipe on how to make a keto friendly pizza. All right.
Whether we lose or gain weight in a certain time frame can be dependent upon a lot of variables, as you have come to learn so far. Yet, there is one big misconception going around, and that is that our environments are the reason for us either gaining or losing weight. And although it's true that our environments can enhance our journey, we should take a closer look at our genetics. You see, back in the 1980s, Dr. Albert J. Stunkert studied a sample of 540 Danish adult adoptees and compared them to both their adoptive and their biological parents. Now, the goal was to find out whether our genetics or our environment make it more likely for us to gain weight. Astonishingly, he found that regardless of whether the adoptive parents were fat or thin, there was no difference in the weight of the adoptive child. However, when it came to look at the biological parents in comparison, there was a consistent correlation between their weights. And further research by Dr. Stunkert found that approximately 70% of our tendency to either gain weight or lose weight easily resides in our genetic predisposition. Now, this does not mean that we cannot actively do something against it, since the remaining 30% are still left in our control. The experiment is almost over. We're in day 19, if I'm not incorrect right now. And what I've decided to do over the past few days was I embarked on a 36-hour fast. And usually I must say that my fast window doesn't exceed the 24-hour mark, but I was actually feeling so good about myself that I decided to go for a 36-hour fast. It turned out to be really well. Well, in fact, it turned out to be so good that I managed to extend it even longer to a 38-hour fast. The only problem I had in between that 36-hour fast was about the 24-hour mark, I experienced kind of like I was feeling kind of weak. From the mental perspective, I was feeling a little foggy and all that. And so what I decided to do is I drank a little bit of green tea with some coconut oil. That helped a lot. That helped a lot because now I'm back into traditional keto, but I wanted to give it a try, give it a shot and see if I could actually sustain it. And surprisingly, not to the end of the experiment, I'm actually seeing some really great results when it comes to how I feel and the way and how resilient my body is overall, which is even more important when we consider the fact that the key of a lifestyle is not just to look good, but more importantly to feel good and to be able to perform well in our everyday tasks. So that's it for today. I really enjoyed the 36-hour fast. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life, ladies and gentlemen. And that is how you finish it off. Day number 20 of the experiment is officially over, and now it's time to kind of summarize and go a little bit through the entire experience. First of all, I would like to say that it was not easy. Being put in a position where you have to give up everything that you have come to adopt over the years, over just experience and mistakes and tinkering tests, it's hard to be put in a position where you have to do the complete opposite. Because this experiment was not just about eating these foods that you can see right here, it was all about giving up lifestyle habits that makes you a better person. And this impacted me a lot because as you can see through this entire journey, I went through a lot of ups and downs in that first phase. Luckily, because of all of the great advice that I've had over the past years, the great people that I've had the chance to work with, and based on my experience and previous mistakes, I was kind of able to get back to where I was when I started. And this really helped me to show that it's actually possible. And now it's also time to take a look at what I actually look like. Why do I look physically? Because one thing is me telling you how I feel, the things that I experienced from internally, the way I felt, the way I experienced this whole journey. But the other thing is also the way I look. So it's time to check out what the final result after day 20 of this experiment looks like. And so that is it with this 20-day experiment. If you're watching this, if you would like to learn more about like this low-carb, high-fat, ketogenic style lifestyle, and if you would like to learn kind of like the step-by-step system, because you may have already consumed some of my content online, and if that has already helped you in terms of the way you look and how you feel about yourself, just imagine how much better you could become if you actually learned my entire methodology system. So click the link on this page and I look forward to helping you.